Is everybody watching?
Everyone paying attention?
Everybody paying attention now. Okay, class, here we go.
Here we go.
Is demonstrate what happens when you add hydrochloric acid to zinc. So Ashton, thank you for coming up to help us today. Let's give Ashton a round of applause for being
Ashton.
Great.
Ashton.
Right. So first we're gonna put some zinc in here. This is just like what they call mesh zinc. It means it's like little granules of zinc. Just a little bit. It's also called an active metal because it reacts readily, especially with hydrochloric acid. So you're probably wondering what your job is in all this, right? All you have to do is hold the test tube up here, because what we're going to do, okay, let me see if I can get some of this water out. We're going to pretend it's really dry. Okay. All we're going to do is add some hydrochloric acid to the zinc, and then Ashton is going to help catch one of the products of this reaction. Okay, so all you have to do, just hold that test tube over the top here, because what do you see down here?
Bubbles.
Okay, so what kind of gas do you think is being produced in this reaction?
Carbon.
Remember, it's zinc with hydrochloric acid. What kind of gas do you think might be produced here? Zinc with hydrochloric acid. It's a very lightweight gas, atomic number one.
Helium.
Hydrogen gas, yeah. Hydrogen gas, yeah. Now, to be hydrogen gas, you have to have two atoms of hydrogen coming together to make a gas molecule. So we got a lot of hydrogen gas, hopefully trapped in here, and we kind of had it slightly vented to let out some of the old air that's in there, because, you know, it was not an empty test tube, it had air in it. But hydrogen is less dense, so it should float up to the top, right? Do you know what another property is of hydrogen that we know and love? What else do we know about hydrogen? You just hold that real steady right there. You got that? I'm going to move mine away. Hydrogen is also flammable. Are you ready? Are you ready?
No.
Let's see if she really caught some hydrogen.
All
right. Let's give another round of applause for Ashton for being brave. Now, Ashton, before you run off, what do you see inside the test tube that's stuck to the inner walls of this test tube? Yeah, water. She sees water all on the inside that's condensed. Because what did we make in that last reaction? Water. All right, let's give her one more round of applause. Thank you.
I thought that was ridiculous, that was.
Well. I liked it when she was asking the class. I don't know how many people are in the classroom. Let's say there's probably at least 10. But she asked everybody, well, what gas is being generated?
Not many people really knew, did they?
Understanding, you know, we all know it's hydrogen gas. But it made me laugh when someone said helium. And there's me thinking, but helium
is hydrogen.
Hydrogen.
Without the impurities.
Helium is hydrogen without the flammable impurities.
Absolutely, yeah.
Because they take out the flammable impurities from the hydrogen gas to make your helium.
Absolutely, of course, yes. But the main thing is that right at the end she said that she convinced Ashton that they made water.
Water in their test tube.
Liquid water condensed on the side of inner walls of the test tube,
yeah.
Convinced Ashton that water, hydrogen,
reacting,
the reaction of hydrogen in oxygen because of the air, okay, produces water.
Water,
and yet that's absolute rubbish
in our opinion,
of course,
because what
the teacher failed to tell Ashton is that there's water in the hydrochloric acid. Absolutely.
And you and I both know that water migrates.
Water migrates, absolutely.
Especially when there's a reaction.
Yeah, water can turn into a vapour. It can turn into a gas.
Well,
it can be imperceptible.
Well, there's water vapour here.
There's water vapour here, absolutely. I've got a nice cold glass of water here, and you can feel there's condensation on the side of the glass.
Where did that water come from?
There's a little bit of moisture there.
Must be water in the air.
There's no need for hydrogen and oxygen, is there?
Absolutely, because water can never be created nor destroyed. It can only change from one form to another.
Absolutely. So I think if you and I had a word with this teacher, she wouldn't like our opinions, would she?
No, she wouldn't.
So I think we should get on and annoy a few people, don't you?
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
You can be very intelligent and very good at what you do, and you can still be stupid.
Well, yeah, absolutely. Well, we're back again annoying people with our views and opinions because
a lot of teachers think that water is made of hydrogen and oxygen.
Absolutely. And yet there is another alternative explanation that can account for the observations and which obviously dispute the claim that water is made as a result of a hydrogen oxygen reaction, in that the hydrogen and oxygen change to make new water.
Yeah, because it's our opinion that the water
is already there.
It's already present,
absolutely, of course. But anyway, how are you, Peter? Are you well? Are you well?
I'm well, yes. Are you well? Absolutely. I was actually, I went out today. It's been raining. Must be lots of hydrogen and oxygen in the air.
Absolutely. Lots of H2O around, isn't there?
Absolutely. But I was out today, and I was on a bus.
Oh yeah.
And I heard some guy, because he was playing with his phone. A lot of young people, they're on their phones, and they like to think that they will always be able to look at their phone, go on the internet.
Well, they won't when they're blind, will they?
But when they get older, they'll be wanting less and less of their mobile phone, and thinking, absolutely, this phone is just ruining my eyesight.
Absolutely, of course, yeah.
But anyway, he was talking to some other people who he got on the bus with, and he was saying that the reason why people yawn is because they're lacking the oxygen into their bloodstream or whatever.
Into the body.
And I'm thinking, but hold on, the air is meant to be of certain percentage of
certain
oxygen.
Certain percentage. How can you
be lacking in oxygen?
So does that mean that if you go into a cupboard and you start breathing into a cupboard,
you should start yawning,
shouldn't you, really, think about it, yeah. Maybe we should find out a little bit of information in this one about
that.
Well,
we could do.
Because it sounds absolutely ridiculous, doesn't it, when you think of it? Because cats and dogs yawn, and it could just be a genuine sign of tiredness.
Absolutely.
There's nothing wrong with being tired.
There's nothing wrong with yawning.
Absolutely, because it's telling us that we need to sleep.
No, what it is, not only that, but what it could be is that when you're at work and you're working away, when you're yawning and everyone's looking at you and everyone's thinking that you didn't get much sleep last night, been up late.
Yeah, what have you
with
been
the hedonistic lifestyle?
Absolutely, yeah.
And then the person would say, oh no, I'm just not getting enough oxygen into my body.
Yeah, it doesn't matter if I was having sex 5 times last night with 3 different women, you know.
Oh, right, yeah.
Or I was shagging the next door neighbour.
Yeah.
You know, and we had the whips out and all of that kind of stuff, And I couldn't get much sleep at all. You know, it's just the fact that my body just needs oxygen.
Absolutely, yeah. And yet, what a lot of people fail to realise is that we're all animals. We're no different to your cat or dog.
Absolutely, of course. There's no different one. Absolutely, of course. Absolutely. Anyway, now, so
let's get on.
Yeah. What have we got for everyone's displeasure then, Peter?
Well, I'm going on the fact that everybody's in a good mood today.
Yep.
But what we're going to talk about is that we're going to focus this on iron.
Absolutely. And you thought iron was an element.
Yeah,
of course.
I was just going to say, an implement, a device, an iron.
Iron the creases out of the element.
Absolutely. No, I was just wondering, because you just yawned. I was thinking, are you not getting enough oxygen?
No, I'm just tired.
We could get our oximeter and say, look.
Oh, right,
of course. It says 20.9% still oxygen. Says,
absolutely, of course.
So how can you be you're getting the amount of oxygen? Just tired. That's all.
Absolutely, because your body absorbs the same amount, allegedly, your body absorbs the same amount of oxygen.
Sorry?
Allegedly. I say allegedly, your body absorbs the same amount of oxygen. So if you're in a room and you remain in that room, and then half hour later you start yawning, well, how can you be lacking in oxygen?
Absolutely. Yeah.
I think it's all rubbish.
Anyway, cool. We're going to revisit the iron pyrite synthesized to magnetite,
because there's a bit of information of course
we didn't mention to everybody. We're going to have a look at the copper. We're going to go back to the copper video,
right?
Because someone left a comment about a comment we left on the video, and we also noted something about the video that we thought, there we go, that's something else that we need to mention.
Yeah.
We're going to have a look at mass spectrometry.
Mass spectrometry.
Because a lot of people out there think, oh, well, of course, water's made of hydrogen and oxygen.
There's mass spectrometry.
That proves that
water's hydrogen.
So we're going to have a look at that.
We're going to have a look at that.
And we're going to have a look at some information about sodium and aluminium.
Sodium and aluminium.
Because this all
ties really nicely.
Ties in with this.
Absolutely.
Because in our understanding, iron is not an element. Iron is actually
an alloy.
An alloy.
Absolutely, of course.
It's a product.
It's a product, absolutely, of course. But before we get on, we've got to do our song.
Absolutely.
We're going to do a song today. Because we're heavily into our iron.
Oh, heavily.
Heavily.
Heavy metal.
Absolutely. We thought we'd do Iron Maiden.
And can't get much heavier than that.
Run to the hills. So here we go. Feel free to join in if you so wish to.
Or you go, come on. You can do it. Come on. Do some headbanging.
White man came across the sea. He brought us pain and misery. He killed our tribes, he killed our creed. He took our game for his own greed. We fought him hard, we fought him well. Out on the plains we gave him hell. But when he came too much to grieve, or will we ever be set free?
Here we go!
Riding through the dust clouds and barren wastes, galloping hard on the plains, chasing the redskins back to their homes, fighting them off their own game. Murder for freedom, a stab in the back, women and children, a coward's attack. Run to the hills. Run for your lives. Run to the hills. Run for your lives. Soldier blue in the barren waste, hunting and killing for game. Raping the women, wasting the men, the only good Indians to tame. Selling them whiskey and taking their gold, enslaving the young and destroying the old. Run to the hills. Run for your lives. Run to the hills. Run for your life. Oh, yeah.
Anyway, there we go. Oh, you got a nice guitar solo there,
Peter.
Oh, yeah. A lot of these, Eric Clapton will be very envious of you, you know. Joe Satriani and all these other people. They wouldn't know what to say, would they? Anyway, thanks everyone. So that's Iron Maiden and Run to the Hills.
Yeah.
And that's what a lot of globies
escape
do.
From man's globe world.
That's what a lot of globies do when they see a flat earther. Quick run.
Absolutely, of course. Now, anyway, so we've got that. So what's our first little bit before we get on? first off. I think we should do, I think we should go and find his comment
yes,
first.
Yes, I
actually,
think we should, yeah.
Because we haven't got it up, so
it'll
I've got
it'll be on
to,
that video.
It'll be on what video?
It'll be on the copper video.
Oh, will it be on the copper video?
It'll be on the copper video. Here we go.
Well, let's have a little. Oh, here we go. Oh, sorry, yeah. Now, this is a video we watched about copper in relation to the colour.
Mm.
And it's our opinion that copper gets its colour from the addition of the red silica sand that goes into the mix. It, you know, when you look at the copper metal and you look at the silica sand, you think, oh, well, yeah, there you go. It makes common sense.
Mm.
Now, I did leave a comment on this video. I did leave a comment on the video here. 423. Now I know where copper gets its colour from. And Robert Cohen, well, no.
Mm,
and I think, okay, well, in your opinion, where do you think copper gets its colour from?
Mm.
And Robert Cohen, copper is reddish brown, red brown, because metals are coloured due to the absorption and re-emission of light dependent on wavelength.
There we go.
Copper has a low reflectivity at short wavelengths, and hence the red hue is preferentially reflected.
Mm.
Right, okay. So I replied, so you're stating light is responsible for the colour of copper.
Wow.
Okay.
Wow.
So light has to be responsible for the colour of the red silica sand as well, yeah?
Well, isn't it strange they call it red silica sand?
Absolutely. And because red silica sand and copper look the same colour, then clearly you, from your statement, these materials have the same ability to absorb and reflect light in the same or similar manner.
Absolutely.
It's a no-brainer of a comment that has left.
Yeah.
No-brainer. So I put, and thanks for being no help at all.
And this is some guy who has gone through the education system, who clearly knows of wavelength, frequency,
light emissions and all this kind of stuff.
Nanometers of the
spectrum.
And yet
he can't see the simplicity of it.
Because he wants to disagree with what you
absolutely
wrote.
Because it goes against his understanding.
Absolutely.
In other words, people are too scared to see the simplicity in something. Are too scared to see the simplicity.
Well, people would put across that there's a pink elephant roaming around the streets of Chester if it supported their viewpoint.
Absolutely, yeah. Just crazy. But one of the things, one of the things that we would like to add to the information in this video, and that is we got to a point where they had the copper concentrate, didn't they?
That's right, yeah.
After the froth flotation, and it got sent, here we go, so here's the
copper concentrate, is about 20 to 30% copper.
20 to 30% copper, because they add other substances to make up the whole 100%.
Like your red silica sand.
But some of the things we forgot to mention before, and that is when it arrives at the smelting plant, copper concentrate has been roasted. It's been through a reverberatory furnace. Okay, because we did mention that before. Mm. We thought it had been roasted or heated or kiln dried or calcined or whatever, but it has been through a reverberatory furnace. And we can see, but just by looking at how dusty this is,
how dry and
dusty it is. Now, when we look at this plant, this section here, what we're seeing here, this is coke. This is a line of coke, and that's been piled up, as it were.
Mm.
And here is your red silica sand, which is being added in layers to your coke. So essentially, in this plant, what they do is they use the copper concentrate that has been through the reverberatory furnace.
And along with the red silica sand and along
with
the
coke to help produce your copper.
They all add it into the furnace.
Which gives you your copper anodes.
Absolutely.
Absolutely, of course. Which then go to the electrolysis place to be electrolyzed.
Nice, absolutely.
And then it goes over to the cathode.
So it does
it's
actually,
so simple, it's unbelievable. Yeah. Unbelievably simple.
So it does actually make you wonder what actually gets moved over
during that electrolytic process. Well, isn't it? It's amazing how the color of the red silica sand migrates.
Mm. Well, that's the only thing.
Through the heat.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
Through the heat, it cools and it's there. It's there, right
that,
there.
That sand is the only thing that I've seen with because everybody knows copper does have a distinct color.
Absolutely, distinct color.
Where does it get the color from? You know.
Absolutely, of course. Now, so we've done that one. What's next then, Peter?
Copper video. Iron pyrite. Let's go on the guy. Let's go back on the iron pyrite.
We've got to do this, haven't we? You'll have to tell me.
Yeah, keep going. That's the one.
There we go. We've got to. Now, we did watch this video. This guy, trying to melt iron pyrite.
Fool's gold.
And we ended up leaving a comment.
And for those who didn't know this one, I left this comment.
Yeah.
If you just make it taxpayer.
There we go.
Yeah. I left this comment. I reckon you synthesize magnetite from your pyrite using the process of calogenation, imbuing the composition of the rock mineral with the surrounding air using heat.
Yeah.
The surrounding air replaces the lost sulfur because when you heat up iron pyrites, the sulfur is lost.
It's lost. In you get sulfur dioxide given off.
Understandable why iron pyrite is not magnetic before heating. Yeah, after heating, it is very magnetic.
Absolutely. Now, what we didn't do on our last, on when we covered this, was actually show some information to support that view that heating iron pyrite will turn it or change it into a magnetic substance.
Well, you and I both know that iron pyrite is not magnetic.
Iron pyrite's not magnetic.
It's not magnetic.
Absolutely, yeah, we know that. Yeah, we know that. Yeah,
but just for those people.
Yeah, we know. It's not, it's
not magnetic.
It's not magnetic at all, yeah. But there's somebody left a comment here. Revive toxicity. Hey, that powder is magnetic.
Yeah.
And even the uploader, it sure is, my friend. Isn't it? Yeah. Blah blah blah.
And somebody else.
And there was somebody else.
Keep going.
Yeah, nearly there.
The crude lab.
Mm. Now you should get the powder and put a magnet next to it. The pyrite, when melted, should burn the sulfur away and give you iron. And since the iron was spread apart, then you should get magnetite, which is an iron oxide,
very magnetic.
It's surprising even this guy is on the ball as well. You know, it's all about
apart from one particular thing at the end.
Oh, sorry, yeah. Yes, mate, it is extremely magnetic, but unfortunately I didn't show that part in the video. I stuffed up and deleted that part while editing.
Mm.
The crude lab, low call, it's pretty much black sand.
Mm.
You know, Robert Schmidt wrote, I thought iron oxide was just simply rust.
Mm.
Mm. This is the whole point.
Mm.
Yeah. Doesn't then you should sense, get magnetite, it? Which is iron
oxide. Fe304, is it?
Fe304, something like that.
It's an iron oxide. And yet you think, but how can rust be iron oxide?
How can two things be an oxide and have different characteristics? It doesn't make sense, does it? That's because a lot of chemistry doesn't make sense.
Oh, but iron, even rust, the iron oxide
is
magnetic.
He did actually have in his iron pyrite, right at the end, I'm sure he had some kind of
brown bits.
He had some brown bits, didn't he?
Mm.
Right at the end. I'm just waiting to see if we can. Yeah, when we see him sifting through this, you can see that there's some reddish bits.
There.
Wait there. I think he actually pulled out.
But the question is,
you can see some reddish bits. Not many.
Yeah. But the question is,
there's a reddish bit there. You know.
But
the
question is, because this relates to the theme for this video, and that is, was the iron present before he applied heat to the iron pyrite?
Absolutely. Or was it there afterwards?
Or did he actually make it using the heat?
Absolutely. I think it was, in my opinion, I think it changed the iron pyrite is changed to become iron through the process of heat.
Yeah, basically, I would agree.
I don't think there's any iron in iron pyrite. That's my opinion.
Absolutely,
because it doesn't rust. It doesn't show any signs of rusting. Showing iron oxide. When exposed to water.
Absolutely.
So, you know. But anyway, so that's that over and done with. That's that. What next then, Pierre?
So we've done that. Oh,
well, we're going through quite well, aren't we?
Well, let's have a look at some mass spectrometry.
Okay, let's have a look at some mass spectrometry. Here we go. Mass spectrometry. Now, lots of people seem to think that water is made of hydrogen and oxygen. And we had a comment today by somebody who said to us that people like us who think water isn't made of hydrogen and oxygen, they couldn't really give us much credence.
Absolutely.
Because we think that. And yet I think, so we replied and we said, but hold on a minute, whoa, you've got no proof that water's hydrogen and oxygen. Mm. So why, there's no credence in what you're saying. Your information cannot be relied upon.
Absolutely. So people can think that you and I, how can we accept
what we're being honest?
How can we accept what you guys are saying? You guys are saying there's no hydrogen and oxygen in water. So how can we accept anything else that you guys say?
Absolutely. All we're saying is that we don't know what water is. We know that it's not hydrogen and oxygen in our opinion.
And I will say that for someone who just first comes on this and comes across this viewpoint, I can understand that how they can arrive at that conclusion.
Oh yeah.
But what they fail to realise is that we have looked at
we've looked at a number
of sources, lots of information about water being hydrogen and oxygen, and we consider that information
doesn't prove at all
that water is made of hydrogen.
There's no proof at all. Just like there's no curvature of the Earth. There's curvature of the Earth. There's no proof that we breathe in oxygen either.
Absolutely.
There's no proof that plants absorb carbon dioxide and release oxygen in their natural environment.
There's no proof.
That fish breathe in water.
Fish breathe in oxygen.
They breathe in water, don't they? Of course. Do apologise. I got it right, but I should have said that there's no proof that fish breathe in oxygen and release carbon dioxide.
There's no proof that there's oxygen in water.
In fact, there's very little proof of anything.
In other words, but in our understanding, the only time the oxygen is in water is when you heat water up.
When you heat water up, there will be, because what happens is that, because oxygen is the heat carrier, and that the heat carrier will expand, won't it?
Yeah,
because the gas expands.
Yeah,
absolutely, of course. As opposed to being compressed, it'll expand.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
So it's the opposite of that's why it's considered to be air that's released in the bubbles when you boil water.
Whereas in fact it's...
Because it's expanded, whereas oxygen is compressed.
Mm.
So it's not oxygen that's released from the water, it's just air, because it's just, if you can relate to that, But anyway.
Some people would say that mass spectrometry is a method that is utilised
by science
to determine... water is made of hydrogen and oxygen.
Absolutely, of course.
Now, one thing when we quickly go through this information, one thing everyone has to bear in mind is that this information, when we talk about water being made of hydrogen and oxygen, well, mainstream's understanding is that it's a liquid. Yeah, so we have to look at any information that relates to liquid.
Liquids, absolutely, of course. So anyway, so let's get through this. Okay, there's not much. Mass spectrometry is an analytical technique that measures the mass to charge ratio of ions. Now, first off, we've got to recognise that ions are just an idea. That's all they are. They're just an idea.
Just a theory.
Believe it or not, they're just an idea. There is no proof that ions exist.
Mm.
Okay? None whatsoever. The results are typically presented as a mass spectrum, a plot of intensity as a function of the mass to charge ratio. Mass spectrometry is used in many different fields and is applied to pure samples as well as complex mixtures.
Mm-hmm.
A mass spectrum is a plot of the ion signal as a function of the mass to charge ratio. These spectra are used to determine the elemental or isotopic signature of a sample, the masses of particles and of molecules, and to elucidate the chemical identity or structure of molecules and other chemical compounds. Now, we've also got to mention that particles and molecules have, there's no proof that they are actually true, that they
just
are
a theory.
They're just an understanding. That's all they are. Nothing more, nothing less.
And we also have to bear in mind that mainstream puts across that water is a chemical compound.
It's a chemical compound. But there's no proof. Remember, no. You've always got to remember this. If you doubt us, if you doubt our opinions or our views, go and find, see if you can go and find some proof yourself. You know, there's lots of information online. In a typical mass spectrometry procedure, a sample, which may be solid, liquid or gas, is ionized, for example, by bombarding it with electrons. This may cause some of the sample's molecules to break into charged fragments or simply become charged without fragmenting. These ions are then separated according to their mass to charge ratio, for example, by accelerating them and subjecting them to an electric or magnetic field. Ions of the same mass to charge ratio will undergo the same amount of deflection. The ions are detected by a mechanism capable of detecting charged particles, such as an electron multiplier. Results are displayed as a spectrum of light, blah, 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 blah. Right, so all they do basically is that they put electricity through it.
Basically, yeah.
That's all they do.
Yeah, but,
the trouble is, water doesn't conduct electricity.
That's because it has no ions in it.
That's because it's got no ions there.
No.
So you can't. Whatsoever. You can't really use this understanding as evidence that water is hydrogen and oxygen and water is an ionic substance.
Let's have a look at the information about referring to liquids.
Referring to liquids, that would be
liquid
chromatography.
Because chromatography is another method that supplements the mass spectrometry analysis. Absolutely.
Yeah, so if they're unsure about the substance that they're testing or trying to identify, and they would use a backup secondary test, which could be liquid chromatography. Mm. Similar to gas chromatography, mass spectrometry, liquid chromatography, mass spectrometry, separates compounds chromatographically before they are introduced to the ion source and mass spectrometer.
Mm. So how are you going to split the water into hydrogen and oxygen?
Well,
so that you can then introduce them to the ionic source.
Yeah, how are you going to split that hydrogen and oxygen that's allegedly in water? It differs from gas chromatography in that the mobile phase is liquid, usually a mixture of water and organic solvents instead of the gas. Most commonly, an electrospray ionization source is used in LCMS. Other popular and commercially available LCMS ion sources are atmospheric pressure chemical ionization and atmospheric pressure photoionization. There are also some newly developed ionization techniques like laser spray.
Mm.
Now, how does this prove that water is made of hydrogen and oxygen? So
it doesn't.
Doesn't.
My understanding of this is that the liquid chromatography is only analysing what they put into
what they add to the water, and then they chuck their electric current at it or whatever, to pick up
the ion source,
to register all of the electrical activity, the ionic activity. Because as we know, electrons is the only reason why they have the ion idea is because they want to, it's their only way that they can explain the conductivity of electrolytes in solution. They can't use electricity and electrons, the flow of electrons. So they use ions. It's only a thought. But all of this is just built upon the fact that you need to add something to the water in order for it to generate electricity, for electricity to flow, for ions to flow.
So that their equipment will work.
So their equipment will work.
Can monitor something.
Absolutely.
Because even their equipment is reliant on electricity.
Think about it. You know, these people, scientists, use electricity as the very basis to power all of their gadgets and gizmos.
Yeah.
Electricity.
Yeah.
Man is confined with electricity.
Yeah.
He can't go beyond electricity.
Absolutely.
Can he really?
No.
No.
He's reliant on it.
He's reliant on it. Electricity. Even to pick up waves, radio waves or some kind of,
do we need to go
microwaves.
On that, do we need to go on that video of the tutor, the lecturer who confirms that water's not doesn't conduct electricity, just to remind people?
Our tutor. I suppose we could do.
Very quickly. It's on our channel, like videos.
Oh, here we go. Yeah, let's just go on to our channel.
Just to remind people.
Because just to remind people, we've got to drive this nail home, haven't we? It's not there. No,
oh,
it's what we actually made. We've got to go here. We've got to show people this just to...
As a reminder.
As a reminder, because, there are people out there.
Here he is.
Here he is. This is the guy. This is the lecturer that basically confirms that water itself does not conduct electricity. So I don't know where he says it. Where do you think he says it?
He says it. Boom, just play.
But I know water conducts electricity, so it must be an electrolyte. And they based this upon the fact that they probably heard never to, for example, let an electrical appliance fall into a bathtub because you get electrocuted. That water, quote, conducts electricity. But that's misleading. Tap water will conduct electricity. Pure water basically doesn't. And the reason tap water conducts electricity isn't because of the water, it's because tap water has dissolved minerals in it. Minerals are ionic substances. So virtually any conductivity you see in tap water isn't due to the water itself, but is due to the substances that are dissolved in the water.
Yeah, it says it very succinctly, reflects our position. You need to add something to water in order for you to get any kind of detection of any electrical activity from the ions. If we accept ions to be, real.
To accept the ionic theory.
To accept the ionic theory. But essentially, mass spectrometry, when you look at it, you need for them to identify whatever is in water, and even for them to use liquid chromatography to get some kind of spectrum of light or whatever, some kind of build-up of picture of what substances are in the water, you've got to add something to water. They cannot do water and get oxygen and hydrogen.
Absolutely.
Can't do it because the water doesn't conduct electricity.
And also, if you put something...
In other words, the ions, the electricity, that when they bombard the water with electrons, they'll just go through they probably don't even go through the water. I mean, what would they do?
It depends what's in the water.
But that's the thing.
We both know that water decomposes.
Absolutely.
So if you put anything in water, the water will decompose.
Absolutely.
Whatever is in it. It might take some time for certain metals, for example.
Yeah.
But it will decompose.
Absolutely. If we go back to here, in a typical mass spectrometry procedure, a sample, let's say it's just water. Okay. Let's say it's deionized water. So deionized means there's no ions in the water.
Yeah.
A sample, let's say deionized water, is ionized, for example, by bombarding it with electrons. But how can it be ionized by bombarding it with electrons?
You have to add something to it.
You've got to add something to water in order for the electrons to be bombarding.
So it sounds like, from this information, it sounds like they're monitoring the reaction or the activity of something that reacts with the
bombardment of electrons.
Yeah,
absolutely.
They put something in the water and then bombard that with electrons.
Yeah, and what they've done is that if they've tested so many substances, they know the patterns.
They know the spectrums and
everything. So they can basically compare which one that they've got, what substance is in the water.
Basically, that's
essentially what they can do. You know, I mean, there's no way they're doing the water. There's no way.
In our opinion,
you know, this does not prove at all that water is hydrogen and oxygen.
Sorry.
That's our view. Let us know what you think.
Absolutely.
Do you think like us? Do you think mass spectrometry is a waste of time in determining the presence of hydrogen and oxygen as constituents of water? Or do you think that it does actually do detect those substances?
Yeah, because if you do think that,
we'd love to see
someone actually carry out
the test.
Absolutely.
Oh, absolutely. We could. That's what we could do. We could ask everyone out there who's watching to actually go and look for a video where they're actually carrying out the test.
Absolutely.
And showing that water is hydrogen and oxygen.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Without adding anything to it.
Absolutely.
And just bombarding it with electrons.
And bearing in mind, the water doesn't conduct electricity.
Absolutely. So that's going to be a hard job for all those electrons to actually go through, isn't it? If the water doesn't conduct electricity.
Yeah, but that's why they'll have to add something to the water.
Oh, right. But then it becomes a solution.
Absolutely.
You know, so anyway. But so there you go. So of course, yes. Anyway, so what next then, Peter? I think
it's very similar to, pH. You know, pH, water is neutral.
Water is neutral.
Water is always neutral, and if you're pHing normally something that you add to the water.
Absolutely. When you pH something, you're basically testing what's in the water, whether it's acidic or alkaline.
Yeah.
It's got nothing to do with water.
Yeah.
The water is just the medium
in which those acids or alkalis are being carried.
Absolutely, of course. So there we go.
The mass spectrometry and water is very similar in that understanding.
Absolutely, of course. So anyway, so that's that one out of the way. Absolutely, of course, yes. We're getting good at this, aren't we?
Well, we are, yeah.
Of course.
Let's have a look at the iron. And you thought iron was an element.
There you go. And you thought iron was an element. Well, in our opinion, you'd be absolutely wrong.
We've also got a touch on the sodium as well.
Well, you should just bear that one in mind then. But
why aren't you getting enough oxygen?
I'm just tired, really. I've had a long day today.
Why aren't I yawning? If you're not getting enough oxygen, why aren't I?
Oh, right, yeah. Because allegedly our bodies absorb same amount of oxygen. Oh, absolutely, yeah. Why is it
everybody should be yawning?
Oh, but then they do say that yawning is contagious, don't they? Right, okay.
That's because everyone would just love to have a sleep.
Absolutely, because everybody's tired, really.
Yeah.
Lots of people
are working on it. Look at 2:00 in the afternoon. Everybody would love to just fall asleep at their desk.
Absolutely. Getting up early in the morning going to work.
Putting up with lots of people in the traffic queue.
On the train.
On the train or whatever.
Putting up with all that stress of people.
People
stress.
Bombarding. Not electrons, but people. Bombarding.
Bombarding.
Stressors.
Absolutely, of course.
Bombarding.
Yeah. Who wants to put up with all that rubbish?
Absolutely,
yeah, of course. But anyway, now, so we're on our segment about iron. Now, it's a very basic substance, iron, isn't it?
You could actually argue, what actually is it, iron?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, if somebody asked me the question, what is iron, I'd say, well, it's a product made from iron ore.
Well, it's a product made from a rock.
Made from a rock, absolutely, of course. That's what it is, actually, you know. But anyway, now, so iron is a chemical element with the symbol Fe. Atomic number 26. It is a metal that belongs to the first transition series and group 8 of the periodic table. It is by mass. There we go. Oh, a bit too much there. It is by mass the most common element on Earth, forming much of the Earth's outer and inner core. Here we go. We're in that inner core again, where they've only drilled down 8 miles, and yet they seem to know, with their S&P waves, that you've got iron in the core of the Earth.
Oh, right. But the S&P waves can still work even on a flat Earth.
Absolutely, of course. It is the fourth most common element in the Earth's crust. Pure iron is very rare on the Earth's crust.
Pure iron, yeah.
Mm. Basically being limited to meteorites.
How can that be? Pure iron.
Iron ores are quite abundant, but extracting usable metal from them requires kilns or furnaces capable of reaching 1500 degrees centigrade or higher, about 500 degrees higher than what is enough to smelt copper. Humans started to dominate that process in Eurasia.
It sounds like man is making the iron.
Iron, absolutely, of course. We had the Iron Age, didn't we?
Oh, right, yeah.
Remember, we had the Iron Age, you know. So they've been making iron for a very, very, very long time.
What are iron alloys such as steel? Inox.
And special steels are now by far the most common industrial metals because of their mechanical properties and their low cost.
Well, mainly because of their low cost.
And their strengths. Yeah. They're very, very strong indeed. So there we go. Pristine and smooth pure iron surfaces are mirror-like silver grey. However, iron reacts readily with oxygen and water to give brown to black hydrated iron oxide. Now, we've already discovered that, we've already developed our opinion that it's just the water that basically reacts with iron to give you your iron oxide in the presence of air.
Because the water decomposes.
Water decomposes.
It's got nothing to do with oxygen because oxygen preserves a substance.
It's a drying agent. It will dry something out.
It will repel the moisture.
It will repel the moisture. Absolutely, of course. So we've got that. You've got a lot of rubbish. You've got a lot of rubbish here, in my understanding. But anyway, now let's have a look to see how it's made. Production of metallic iron. Here we go. Production of metallic iron. For a few limited purposes, when it is needed, pure iron is produced in the laboratory in small quantities by reducing the pure oxide or hydroxide with hydrogen or forming iron pentacarbonyl and heating it to 250 degrees centigrade so that it decomposes to form pure iron powder.
But hold on. Is that actually a pure substance? In other words, what I'm saying is, do they actually get the ore from the ground? Do they actually dig it up from the ground?
Absolutely,
and
so, yeah.
And then they just melt it down and it magically turns to a metal.
Well, the main industrial route of iron, I mean, this is everybody should know this, but nowadays the industrial production of iron or steel consists of two main stages.
Well, can I just say something?
Yeah.
Isn't it interesting how they always use iron or steel interchangeably?
Absolutely, yeah.
In some ways.
But we've got to remember, iron or steel. Iron is supposed to be an element, whereas steel is an alloy.
But
I use the words interchangeably.
But iron and steel could be the same thing.
Absolutely, of course.
But steel could just have a few more extra bits added to it.
Absolutely. It consists of two main stages. In the first stage, iron ore is reduced with coke in a blast furnace, and the molten metal is separated from gross impurities such as silicate minerals. This stage yields an alloy, pig iron. So basically what they're saying is that they've got impurities in the metal, but they're still calling it iron.
Yeah, but this stage yields an alloy, and they're calling it pig iron.
Yeah, it does make sense.
It does make sense.
That contains relatively large amounts of carbon. You see, the thing is, because they're putting coke in the blast furnace, you're obviously going to get coke in your product. So the coke is alloyed with your iron ore to produce your pig iron. So there, straight away, in the iron, you've got two substances. It's an alloy.
Yeah.
Iron is an alloy of coke and iron ore.
So basically, what we're saying is that if you don't put the carbon in it,
you're not going to get the iron metal.
You won't get the iron metal, absolutely. In the second stage, the amount of carbon in the pig iron is lowered by oxidation to yield wrought iron, steel, or cast iron. Other metals can be added at this stage to form alloy steels.
So what they're doing by reading this,
they're still keeping the carbon there.
Yeah, but the amount of carbon will determine the product that comes out at the other end.
Absolutely, of course. I mean, we don't really need to know much about the blast furnace processing. The blast furnace is loaded with iron ores, usually hematite or magnetite. Now, we came across magnetite before.
Yeah.
There we go. There you go. Fe304.
Together with coke.
Coal that has been separately baked to remove volatile components. Maybe a lot of sulfur, for example.
Well, the salts.
The salt, absolutely, of course. So air preheated to 900 degrees centigrade is blown through the mixture in sufficient amount to turn the carbon into carbon monoxide. Reaction raises the temperature to about 2000 degrees centigrade. Carbon monoxide reduces the iron ore to metallic iron.
See, this is another thing about this information, that is, it's giving people the impression that the coke is being transferred, the carbon is being transferred into a gas
and leaving
carbon monoxide, which will leave the iron ore.
But what they're failing to tell people is that the coke, a large proportion of the coke remains attached to the iron.
Yeah, some iron in the high temperature, lower region of the furnace reacts directly with the coke.
Absolutely, of course, there you go, you've got the coke. A flux such as limestone, calcium carbonate or dolomite, calcium magnesium carbonate, so you've already got carbon there. You've got carbon there. It's also added to the furnace's load. Its purpose is to remove siliceous minerals in the ore, which would otherwise clog the furnace. The heat of the furnace decomposes the carbonates to calcium oxide, which reacts with any excess silica to form a slag composed of calcium silica or other products. Blah, 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 blah. It's very, very clear that in iron there is carbon.
Well, we've actually... Where we've got some steel wool, and we've decomposed it,
you will get your carbon,
coke and iron ore.
Coke and iron ore, absolutely, because that's your main constituents of your
absolutely
iron,
yeah,
or your steel. Sorry, yeah, absolutely, of course. So you don't need to be a brain. I don't know why they call this an element. An element.
Yeah, I can't work
for the life of me work out why they call it an element.
Yeah. Because it's a product.
Even when we look at the iron powder,
yeah.
You know,
it looks
it's very rare. This iron metal, pure iron, is very, very, very hard to manufacture. Pure iron is produced in the laboratory in small quantities. Only small quantities.
Yeah. When needed.
Only when needed as well.
Mm.
And they're reducing the pure oxide or hydroxide with hydrogen or forming iron pentacarbonyl. So there's carbon present, and heating it to 250 degrees centigrade so that it decomposes to form pure iron powder.
So without the carbon, there's no iron metal.
Another method is electrolysis of ferrous chloride onto an iron cathode. There's carbon in the cathode, even in the electrode, the anode, which will decompose.
Well, there's carbon. Oh, right, yeah, in the iron, but even in the iron cathode.
Even in the iron cathode, there's carbon present. Yeah,
present. It doesn't take a brain box to work out that with regard to iron, if you haven't got carbon, you won't have the metal.
You won't get the metal, absolutely, of course.
Iron cannot be an element.
Iron can't be an element.
The metal iron cannot be an element in our understanding. It has to be a compound.
It's got to be an alloy.
An alloy.
It's got to be a compound. A product. It's something that is made. So when we do look at pictures like this, you know, this is a product.
Mm.
It's not iron an element. This is absolutely just rubbish. In our opinion,
yeah.
Of course. Anyway, that was easy, wasn't it?
Absolutely.
They're getting easier and easier and easier.
Well, let's have a look at our last bit on the sodium.
On the sodium, yeah, of course. Now we
we covered aluminium, didn't we? And the production of aluminium. And it is our opinion that when one decomposes aluminium, you'll get a white salt, and you will also get a black substance. Now, in our understanding, the black substance is carbon. Carbon that's, if the aluminium has been manufactured by the whole Herold process, the carbon is the result of the decomposition of the anode, the carbon anode, the carbon mixed with clay anode.
Absolutely.
Decomposition. And it basically ends up the carbon. That anode decomposes and ends up in the mix.
Yeah. So you could actually argue without the carbon.
Without the carbon.
There's no aluminium.
There's no aluminium metal. Now, we found some information.
Oh, because we did ask, because we had someone leave a comment about this particular topic, and we asked, you know, show us some aluminium.
Without the carbon.
That you can decompose.
And there's no carbon.
That won't turn black.
Well, because part of it won't.
Because if it doesn't turn black, then you know that there's no carbon.
You know that there's present. You know there's no carbon.
Yeah.
But we're still waiting, aren't we?
Still waiting.
Now, sodium. This is a little piece of information that supports our opinion. Okay. So let's go. Sodium was first isolated.
This was sodium metal.
This is sodium metal. Yeah, sodium was first isolated by Humphrey Davy in 1807 by the electrolysis of sodium hydroxide. Among many other useful sodium compounds, sodium hydroxide is used in soap manufacture and sodium chloride, blah, blah, blah. Right, okay, so we know a little bit that it was made to. So here, am I right?
Yep. Well, this is the next one down.
So this is the next one down. Wait there.
Keep going.
Occurrence? No.
No.
No, not that one.
Commercial production.
Commercial production. Okay. Employed only in rather specialised applications, because sodium metal
is very reactive.
It's very reactive. Got to keep it in oil.
Or what we should say is water can easily decompose sodium metal.
Sodium metal, so it's got to be kept in oil. It's got
to be even kept the moisture can decompose it.
Absolutely,
as you and I both have found out with calcium metal.
Absolutely, of course.
Because calcium metal is similar to sodium metal.
Employed only in rather specialised applications, only about 100,000 tonnes of metallic sodium are produced annually. Metallic sodium was first produced commercially in the late 19th century by carbothermal reduction. Carbothermic reactions involve the reduction of substances, often metal oxides, using carbon as the reducing agent.
So now, carbon in sodium metal.
Yeah. Absolutely, yeah. Seems by carbothermal reduction of sodium carbonate. At 1100 degrees centigrade. So what they do is basically they have sodium carbonate and they use coke, a carbon source like coke, coal mixed, because that would give you soda ash.
Yeah, because you and I both know that by adding coke, increases the temperature of the furnace.
Which
so you
means
don't have
you don't
to use a lot of fuel. As much as.
Absolutely, of course. As the first step of the De Ville process for the production of aluminium. Ah, we've got it now. Now, the De Ville process, let's just go on. Hopefully, we'll get another. The De Ville process was the first industrial process used to produce alumina from bauxite. So, obviously, bauxite, in the first stage of aluminium production, they need to make aluminium oxide, and that's manufactured from bauxite, which is mixed with sodium hydroxide. Okay, so we don't need to. It is based on the extraction of alumina with sodium carbonate.
The first stage is the calcination of the bauxite at 1200 degrees centigrade with sodium carbonate and coke.
So there we go. So straight away we've got the presence of coke.
Yeah. Okay, carbon.
The alumina is converted into sodium aluminate. Iron oxide remains unchanged and silica forms a polysilica. In the second stage, sodium hydroxide solution is added, which dissolves the sodium aluminate, leaving the impurities as a solid residue. The amount of sodium hydroxide solution needed depends upon the amount of silica present in the raw material. The solution is filtered off. Carbon dioxide is bubbled through the solution, causing aluminium hydroxide to precipitate, leaving a solution of sodium carbonate. The latter can be recovered and reused in the first stage. There you go. The aluminium hydroxide is calcined to produce aluminium oxide. So it's there. So what we're saying is, before the Hall-Herold process,
well, before that came about,
before that came
they
about,
had to rely on, if you go back on the sodium page,
absolutely,
the high demand for aluminium created the need for the production of sodium metal. And this is where you and I both are on the understanding that aluminium is a sodium-based metal.
And you need to have the carbon coat, whatever, present in order to have the aluminium metal form.
Yeah.
It says here, the introduction of the Hall-Herold process, because I'm not sure when that came about, what year that came in.
For the production of aluminium by electrolyzing a molten salt bath, ended the need for large quantities of sodium. But what they'd actually achieved was that they used cryolite within the Hall-Herold process, which is a sodium.
Which is sodium-based substance.
Chemical. Mineral. Sodium,
hexafluoroaluminum, something like that. A related process based on the reduction of sodium hydroxide was developed in 1886.
So they didn't need to make the sodium metal. Yeah, they didn't need to make the sodium metal to then make the aluminium metal.
Yeah.
They could make the aluminium metal without having to make the sodium metal.
Yeah, they didn't need to. Yeah, absolutely. But you still need the carbon content in order to make the metal.
Absolutely.
The aluminium, the final product. This is the whole point of it. And when you do look at the information, you start to think to yourself, oh, right, yeah, I can understand why there's carbon in aluminium. Because if there's no carbon in aluminium, you can't have the metal.
Absolutely.
It's as simple as that. If that's our opinion. Absolutely. But let us know what you think. Yeah. Do you think you can have aluminium without carbon?
Have you ever made iron metal without using carbon?
Absolutely, of course, you know. Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely, yeah. Of course. I think that wraps us up. That was an easy one.
Yeah, that's because we're getting good at these.
We're zipping through all this, yeah, but
getting good at this.
Anyway, so there we have it. That's it, all over done.
But if we go back to the video we showed at the beginning.
Oh, the video we showed at the beginning. Here we go.
With this teacher. And that is, we're going to show people. We're going to do this demonstration.
Yeah, we'll do this demonstration.
We're going to do this demonstration, and we're going to film, record it, and we're going to show the camera right up close to the test tubes.
Show the test tube right up close to the camera. Yeah.
We'll put the camera up close to the test tubes. And we'll put forward our understanding of what is happening.
Absolutely,
because we certainly disagree with This teacher's understanding,
we
because
think
the water is already present.
It's incorrect. The understanding's incorrect.
Correct. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, but that's just our opinion, of course.
Absolutely.
But, anyway, let us know what you think. You know. So I think that wraps it up. You know. Yeah.
I think we've ironed out
quite a few creases there, Peter. We've done a wonderful job, really. But let us know what you think. Do you think that you can have aluminium without carbon? Do you think iron can be made pure without the presence of carbon? And it is really an element. Do you think aluminium's an element?
Or just products,
yeah, absolutely. Like, do you think also that mass spectrometry can actually detect the hydrogen and oxygen in water? Given even though water cannot conduct electricity,
and even using
which is a flow of electrons,
and even using the additional liquid chromatography.
Absolutely, of course, yes, yeah. Let us know what you think. Drop a comment below.
Yeah, drop
love
a
to hear your
below,
views
yeah.
and opinions, opinions, because that's what we do, express our views and opinions.
Absolutely, because we are on the understanding that there's no oxygen in the air. There's not 20.9% oxygen.
Water's not made of hydrogen and oxygen. Man doesn't know what water is.
Man doesn't know what anything is, really.
Doesn't even know what a pebble on the beach is.
Man only knows what he can do with things.
Do with things, absolutely.
Like turn sand into glass.
Into glass, absolutely, of course. But then it becomes glass then, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
Because it's man-made, of course. Yeah. There we have it. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. And so until next time, always remember, if something doesn't make sense, like
water being
made of hydrogen oxygen.
Oh, two parts, hydrogen.
Absolutely.
Coming together.
When nobody can actually prove it.
Absolutely,
to,
yeah.
Or adequately demonstrate it either.
Absolutely.
Or even thinking the Earth is spinning ball.
Yeah.
Or thinking that all of the
periodic
substances on the periodic table are elements.
Absolutely. When in our understanding, a lot of them are products.
A lot of them, just in our opinion, are products. Of course, but it's all nonsense, isn't it, really?
Absolutely.
Of course, thanks ever so much, and we'll see you next time.
Okay.
Bye.
Ta-da.
The Earth isn't round, it's flat.
How do you know?
I've observed it in all my travels over Europe. It's flat, everywhere it's flat.